So, without further ado, I'd like to introduce Gary. Gary, as I mentioned, is from Australia. So if you say good day, mate, he'll know what you're talking about. Went to college at Queensland for an MBA and an MES. Gary has started 8 startup companies, all tech, if I am correct. Mm-hmm. Okay. And has had some real nice exits. One that you guys may be familiar with is DriveCam, which is now called Lytics, which was just sold a month or so ago. Mm-hmm. Yep. $550 million. It was a public transaction, and Gary was the founder. Gary also started a company called LifeProof, which was purchased by Otterbox 3 years ago.
Yeah.
About
yeah.
right?
Yep.
Okay, mm-hmm. great. And I don't think that amount was disclosed, but the rumor on the street was it was pretty significant again. And he's now the president and co-founder,
yes.
of Interpreta, mm-hmm. which is doing genomic analytics, and they are hoping to disrupt the marketplace pretty significantly. So without further ado, big round of applause for Gary. And really, it's very special because Gary's getting on an airplane in about an hour and a half, and he graciously agreed to be here. So this is, we really appreciate it. Thank you, Gary.
Absolutely. Well, it's great to see you all here tonight. And as much as I'd like to be flattered that you'd like to know more about me, I know that what you're here for really is to learn about entrepreneurship and success. And it's from people like Tom and the rest of you that I learn the ropes over many years of entrepreneurial efforts as well. So it's kind of a bit of tag, pass it on. But we'll definitely have some fun tonight. It's going to be real. It's going to be authentic. So let's see. Where do you want to start, Tom?
Well, and Gary and I had the benefit of talking on the phone last week a little bit, which really helped. It helped me understand a little bit more about him and how he thinks and operates. I think what might help the audience, Gary, is yeah. if you could start off with a little bit more about you. I gave a little bit of the background, but you grew yeah. up in Australia. Maybe you could talk a little bit about your upbringing, your schooling,
sure, yeah.
who might have been influences on you to start pursuing an entrepreneurial path.
Yeah.
Be okay?
Yeah, 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 absolutely.
Thank you.
So, you know, you've heard the kind of Tiger Mom track that you do real well at school, you pull straight A's, you go into Harvard, you get hired by some big company, and you become rich and successful and have a great life. Well, that wasn't my track. I'd have to say I lived a pretty unconventional childhood. And for me, it pretty much started at the age of about 3 years old. And I saw the space program with NASA, the launching to the moon, mission to Mars, all of these other sorts of things. And I just thought that was unbelievable. It was completely amazing, even at the age of 3. I learned to read by the age of 4. My older sister and my mother taught me to read. And so I was reading about the, in the child book encyclopedia, about the great inventors, about Thomas Edison and Louis Pasteur and these other kind of real disruptors of their time. And to me, I thought, you know, for a lot of kids, they know what they want to be when they grow up. They want to be like a fireman or a policeman or something like that. And for me, it was simple. It was just, I want to be an inventor. I want to do something that's going to, in some way, make a little bit of a difference in the world. And just the challenge of doing really things that hadn't been done before was incredibly attractive to me. Of course, when you're 6 years old, you don't really know what you don't know or what is difficult to do or what's possible. And so I just had developed a deep passion for, at that point, the things which I thought were magical were electronics, radio transmitters, the ability to do cool stuff with high voltage explosives and pyrotechnics. So pretty much all that, my entire childhood was one continuous episode, endless episode of Mythbusters. So I developed a reputation in this small town of 2000 as being the mad scientist. And even the school bullies were afraid of me. So, but rather than spending my life in school, I actually found it pretty constraining and boring sitting in the classroom all the time. And so I became very, very good at finding ways to malinger and to not go to school. Of course, you had to up the game, you had to keep on, kind of getting more refined in the art of making it seem like it had some illness. You know, it had to be not so serious that you had to go to the hospital, but enough that you had to stay home from school. And it had to be something that was imminently medically not, you know, diagnosable. So stomach complaints were really good. Occasionally, you know, a little bit of cat food in the toilet was good. But I think my mother kind of knew my caper, but what I was doing is when I was staying at home, instead of being a bum and just lounging about watching TV, I was following my passion, which was learning about electronics, about computers, about designing circuits, about inventing and building things. And pretty much by the age of six, I built my first radio transmitter and then had learned the elementary basics of electronics, what transistors do, what resistors and capacitors and all the rest, to the point that I could start to envision a circuit and then start to create a circuit from scratch. And, you know, I did have one episode where I actually pushed it too far. So I was 10 years old, and I guess my mother had had a, you know, she'd had a visit from the school inspector, superintendent, or whoever, about the amount of school that I was missing. And so there was like nothing was working. You know, I mean, it's just like I was getting bum rushed to school and that was it. And so, you know, I had to kind of up the game a little. So it was like terrible stomach pains. It was just, you know, it was terrible. And so my mother took me to the hospital, and then they gave me a very unpleasant exam involving rubber gloves. And came to the conclusion that I had appendicitis that had to be removed immediately. And so then I was trying to tell them, no, the whole thing is like just, you know, I was just trying to get out of school, really. But they thought, you know, with my blind panic over this whole thing, that I was just afraid of the surgery. And so they basically pinned me down and, you know, had me go through with this surgery. So somewhere there's this pickle jar with my appendix in it. So unconventional. I developed, I guess you'd say, my first kind of really different invention was an automatic car headlight dimmer that I designed when I was 10 years old. And so we put a couple of those in the family car and stuff. And then from there, at the age of 12 was when the personal computer revolution really started to hit. The Apple II, the Atari computer, Commodore 64, you know, those sorts of things. So I started to really get into programming at that age. Everything from assembly language, right, you know, kind of right down to, it wasn't just assembly language, I was right down to byte level, where I'd create the binary code all by hand and build it all up, and then started to build and design add-on cards to do things like digitizing sound and video and all that sort of stuff. And that was at the beginning of the creative revolution with computers too, where the old DOS computers, they had the green screen or the orange screen, and the idea was to develop something you could do some really cool stuff, video editing, to be able to do video titling. And the Commodore Amiga had just come out. It had basically 16 colors in its high-resolution mode. And I thought, what if, at that point, paint boxes were selling for around, the Quantel paint box for around about $100,000. What if I could bring something down that you could use as a video hobbyist to get full color graphics, 16 million colors in full resolution on your desktop, and do it at a price where you could actually afford it? So I came up with my first major venture at the age of 18 called Color Burst. Well, actually before that one, just before I digress to that. At the age of 16, I developed a computer MIDI interface for being able to play your keyboard and stuff and do all your music on your computer. And I started to figure, looking at my time, the labor, the materials, I was kind of doing it all. So I had to be the sales guy going around to the stores, asking if they wanted to buy the interface, the designer, the manufacturing coordinator, you know, kind of taking care of the books, all that sort of stuff. And when I added it all up, I was making about $450 an hour. And I thought, hey, you know, that's not bad. I mean, you know, for a 16-year-old, it's not bad money. I sold about 400 or 500 of those interfaces. And then that got me thinking about the entrepreneurial, you know, lifestyle. And I actually dropped out of high school at the age of 17. So I never actually finished and got my high school degree. So, you know, I felt like a miserable failure for the rest of my life after that. Well, actually, no, not really. But So I started this computer graphics garden. I was living with my parents at the time. A company over in the United States here in Reno, Nevada, heard about it and they wanted to license it. So I flew across, actually won a kind of like a Young Achievers Award in Australia, where they gave you a $20,000 grant to pursue, you know, your dreams and stuff. And this paint box was the concept, and it really took off. It became the de facto. Well, it really took off high volume. But the company that I'd done business with, kind of a small company, was the most profitable product they'd ever had. So they actually decided to take all the profits, not pay me any of the royalties, which had accumulated to $1.5 million, and they actually split the country. So it was an English woman that was the CEO. She literally left all of their factory, everything in Reno, Nevada, all their employees, and just didn't turn up one day. Took all the hard drives and memory and color burst product and all that kind of stuff. So that was my first introduction to being very careful who you do business with. And fortunately from there, another company based here in the States as well, called Creative Computers, they heard about what we had done. That's the same owner of PC Mall and Mac Mall, the owner of Creative Computers. He'd heard about what we'd done and decided to license it and do a second generation product. So that product, it really took off. It became the de facto standard 24-bit graphic card for the Commodore Amiga. And the interesting thing was that while I was running that venture, Steve Jobs called me up when he was founding Next, about inquiring about whether he could use a computer graphics card, the architecture on the Next computer. Now, we didn't end up coming to a deal, but it was just interesting being at the kind of early formative stages of the whole creative revolution with desktop computers. That did very well until Commodore Computers went bankrupt. So when they went out of business, our platform that we were tied to basically disappeared overnight. And we had poured all of the profits from the product sales back into expanding the product range. We were competing against other companies like Avid that did nonlinear editing. So we had a nonlinear editing product. We had real-time video special effects, a custom FPGA design that did real-time transforms of video and all kinds of crazy stuff that for the time was pretty much the leading edge over the top. I'd actually borrowed a couple of $100,000 extra from a strategic partner. So when Commodore went under, I was literally in debt at that point. So it was kind of bleak times. There's some aspects to the story I'll save for another time, involving business partners. But from there, the dilemma was I only had a visa to work for my own company. I didn't have a green card or any other kind of work permit. So my dilemma was, what do I do now? I'm basically completely broke. I owe a couple of $100,000 and I've got no income. So what do you do? And there was many evenings that I slept in the car. I stayed with friends at different places off and on. And at that point, there's nothing like looking over the cliff, feeling the rocks crumble under your toes, and realizing you got to do something because nobody else is going to fix the situation, to make it good for you. I didn't even have enough money for an air ticket back to Australia. And so I was a mountain biker, and I used to like riding at night because it was the only time I got to get out. You know, you're kind of designing all day and all that sort of stuff. And the best bicycle lights on the market was a company called Knight Rider at that point, based here in San Diego. But their bike lights, they sucked. And that's because when you're out there, you'd be having a great time. You get 15 miles away from your car, you're blazing with both the headlights, and you forget, you know, which lights would turn on and all that sort of stuff. And the battery would go flat. You'd have no idea. All of a sudden, the light would just kind of, you know, drop off and be like, oh, man, you know. So you're walking prickles and cactuses and all that kind of stuff in the dark back to the car. So I came up with the idea of, and again, this is, you know, 22 years ago now, so, you know, everything has this now, but how about we do smart charging? How about we do a fuel gauge? How about we do digital lamp out detection? So if one bulb ever blows, it'll switch the other one automatically. These different multi-level brightnesses, SOS in Morse code in case you ever, you know, crash and get stuck somewhere. So their products, they were selling for $200, and I introduced this product, which I licensed to them, that was pushing a $329 price point. And everyone's like, that'll never work. You know, no one will ever pay that much for a bicycle light. Well, again, they went from a $1 million company a year to about a $10 million company a year in about an 18-month period of time. So we pioneered the whole digital lighting market with Knight Rider. So I was with them for about 3.5 years. And right around 1997, you had the crash of Lady Diana. And there was, you know, this whole mystery, like, what happened in that tunnel? How, you know, who was involved? Could it have been prevented? Then you had Swissair Flight 111 that crashed. And again, they spent $38 million looking for the black box recorder. They finally found it. But it struck me as sort of ironic that that was a couple of hundred people. It was very tragic, but you had 41,000 people a year died in the US in 1998 in car crashes, and there was, it was all just basically circumstantial as kind of maybe what happened and how to stop it in the future. So the idea was, what if we could learn from this? Learn from it not just post-collision, but if you could learn from driving events, figure out what constitutes good driving, bad driving, how to identify those risk factors, and also try to imbue a culture of safe driving habits through training and accountability. It's one thing to say, hey, you know, on your whiteboard, whatever you do, don't do that again, you know, with a G-force graph or something. But to be able to actually show it from the driver's perspective and say, this is what happened, the reason why you had to brake so hard, I know you didn't get into a crash, but it was because you're traveling too close to the car in front. So that was the whole notion. And then the final thing that solidified it was a road rage incident where some gang members threw bricks from my windshield because they pulled in front of me in at a traffic light. And they were incensed that I didn't yield as they were trying to jam in front of me. So while I was at Knight Rider, I kind of worked, you put a nice 45-hour day in during the day, and then you're up working until midnight, 2 in the morning on this new product concept. So I was trying to get into a very small package a video camera with an infinite loop. So it would continuously record absolutely everything it sees. And then when it gets triggered by a G-force, like from a, you know, you swerve or you get in a collision or something like that, it would go backwards in time, like 10, 15 seconds, capture all of that event, all of the G-forces and everything associated, and then keep going for an extra 10 or 15 seconds. When you get back to the depot, it gets radioed, you know, basically translated up to the computer, and a professional can look at it and say, hey, this is kind of what happened. Take in, give you a little counseling session, and then everybody learns from it. Well, that one I put in about, I started out getting VC funding, which was really nice. Visa card. So it was. We went out to $120,000 in credit card debt, and at that point in time, you know, I wasn't making that much money. So it was, and I was at the same time I was paying down this $200,000 debt on the previous company. Fortunately, I met some people through Thai. I don't know if any of you know Suren Dutia. Was the founder of Thai Trained Indigenous Entrepreneurs here in town as well. He introduced me to some other folks, which it introduced us to a government grant process. We ended up getting from the National Academy of Sciences, we got a $100,000 grant to essentially build a bunch of these units, test their efficacy, and that got us to the point then where we were kind of fundable, you know. So the San Diego Band of Angels, at that point they were called, and this is about 20 years ago now, by a gentleman named Tom LaFleur, was the kind of spearheaded the process. I met him at an engineering conference. They put in $1 million and kind of got us off to the races. But this is a market where you are pioneering an entirely new product category. So you don't have an analog to point to say, hey, you know, we promise you that this thing will pay for itself in 10 months, because you just have to believe us, right? You know, there's no analog you can actually point to for believability. So what we thought was going to be an easy process turned out to be a very arduous gathering of the data, working with early adopters that were willing to put our system in, that were willing to cooperate with us to help us to analyze the data and to build a business case. And the first 18 months were pretty much wandering in the desert. And it was difficult times for many reasons. The first is that you're having to figure out who is our customer, how do we sell to them, what are their particular pain points, and what are the things in their industry. For example, there was concerns initially about the unions. The drivers are thinking, wait a minute, you're not going to stick a camera in my face, and then if I do, every time I do something wrong, you're going to whack me over the knuckles. So we had to build this trust with them that, no, this is actually looking out for you. When someone pulls in front of you and they crack their brakes on and you rear-end them because that's the laws of physics, there's nothing else you could have done, this thing is going to exonerate you. This is protecting drivers' lives. And over time, we were able to prove that not only did it reduce collisions by a significant amount, it reduced wear and tear on the vehicle, it also reduced fuel consumption, but ultimately it resulted in less workers' compensation claims, reduced liability that was associated with collisions, and it contributed to a workforce where you're demonstrating a duty of care that you're playing towards your employees as well that was unobtainable elsewhere. Now I'm looking in the audience at, do you mind if I single you out? All right, Alan Mann. So Alan Mann is actually, he was the heading up our sales at DriveCam back, would have been at that point around the year 2001, was it?
Yeah, 2002 to
2005. Yep. And, you know, I'm going to throw you on the spot, so instead of stealing your thunder, what were your observations about the difficulties of pioneering and, you know, in the early days before we got our legs under us?
You know, when I joined DriveCam, they had about 2,000 installed units, so there was getting to be an acceptance from the critical mass that, in fact, this technology didn't work. Nobody had seen anything like this before. Every time you talked to a customer, it was always a new idea. Everybody was fascinated and going drawn to video. But the fact was, economically, the ROI was very positive because you could very clearly identify risky driving behavior, put it in front of them, because here's where your exposure to risk is, here's where your liability is, here's the corrective action you need to take to get your liability down. And that worked. The value proposition played to the police directly, played to insurance companies that try to underwrite the risk more appropriately.
Right.
It was a very, very good model.
Yep. So. And correct me if any of the stats have, you know, over time borne out to be different, but what we found was about a 70% reduction in collisions when you installed and used this driver monitoring and training system. And that wasn't just essentially a Hawthorne effect, you know, changing something and having a temporary effect, but it basically kept it there permanently. So I don't know if it translated to 70% less deaths as well, but if it did, you're looking at airbags and seatbelts combined have reduced deaths by about 60%. So potentially, it's been more impactful to safety than airbags and seatbelts
combined,
yeah.
Gary, can you talk a little bit about the markets that you were going after with the DriveCam product?
Sure.
I mean,
we
just heard a little bit about insurance.
Yeah.
I would imagine that teenage drivers.
Well, initially it was basically like, oh yeah, you got a pulse, okay, you know, we'll do business with you. And so we started off with one of the airport shuttle companies here in San Diego was an early adopter. One of the Chevrolet dealerships off the 8 freeway was an early adopter. And so was the San Diego Fire Department. So without those kind of initially getting behind us for those first sales, it's hard to, you know, to get the first proof. But as we started to develop the market, obviously we've got the most liabilities when you're carrying people. So ambulances, in particularly livery transport, so limousines, taxi cabs, airline shuttles, things like that. Also when service vehicles are on the road a lot, so like your rapid routers, your Cox cables, those sorts of companies, they're exposed to a lot of liability with just all the crazy drivers that they have to drive around and things that can happen on the road. So that's where we really started to build the company out. And then there was the fast followers as well. So there was another company in town here called Smart Drive. And so they were a fast follower. There was a lot of, I guess you'd say, creative recruiting that they had going on as well. And we even had some mysterious circumstances around a burglary and break-in that we received some very tantalizing evidence coming back from, that a competitor, I won't name them, may have had something to do with that as well. So, you know, there was definitely a certain amount of intrigue and treachery that happens when you start to get into interesting new markets and pioneering as well. So I stayed with the company from, I was the founder and CEO from, I started working on it in 1997, instantiated the company in 98, obtained the funding in 99, and essentially in the year 2000 I decided to bring on a president so that I could focus on product development. And I remained with the company until the year 2003. I'd like to, one of my major reasons for leaving was my father did come down with terminal cancer in Australia, and I wanted to go back and spend some time with my father before he went and he would support the family afterwards. But there was also some growth and transition pains that takes place when you're, when you have a certain amount of inexperience growing a hyper growth company. So at that point, you know, there were some hard lessons I had to learn. Some of those lessons were not necessarily being the obstructive founder, but being the overly conceding and overly helpful founder in certain circumstances, to where I gave too much control and too much credence to certain individuals, which essentially took a Machiavellian opportunity to try to take over the company. There was also aspects of it where I wasn't experienced enough, and where I wasn't ready to be running a, you know, a $200 million a year company. So there's a great book by Noam Westerman called The Founder's Dilemma, and I think it's a wonderful, it's kind of required reading for entrepreneurs. And just because you're not ready at age, you know, 24 to run a, you know, $100 million company or whatever, a couple of million dollar company, doesn't mean to say you won't be at, you know, at 34 or, you know, or 26, or as long as you learn your lessons. The most important thing is to be continually learning and to never get complacent.
How about 54?
I'll be looking forward to trying that.
Me too. Thank you. You just shared some of the challenges,
yes,
that you had at DriveCam,
yes,
and you left in 2003, if I remember correctly.
Yep.
When you went back to Australia, that's when you went back to college.
Yes.
Is that right?
It is, actually. And, you know, there's this odd little thing about not graduating from high school that you can get in the way of that. and so, fortunately, I wasn't just drinking beer and watching football all that time. But I visited Queensland University of Technology. They had an open night there, and I was thinking of maybe going and looking at either the business school or engineering school. And my wife, she kind of said, you know, she has a lot of faith in me, and having people around you to have a lot of faith in you is a good thing. Most of the time, this was a great thing, but it was a little bit more intrepid than, you know, than I was quite ready for. She said, you know, if you're going to go to university, because we're about to go back to the US again, I don't want to like go back to the US and then, you know, just kind of have you come back here again to piddle around with university or whatever. Why don't you go for the jugular? Why don't you tell them you want them to let you into the master's program without an undergraduate degree, and you want them to give you a full scholarship? Which I thought was really a little too audacious, but I thought, well, if I raised $1 million, you know, on a PowerPoint, I could probably at least give it a shot.
Sure.
So I met with the dean of the business school, and he was just looking at me like, who the hell are you, you know, that you're even coming in here and asking for this? And he said, well, look, I can't just give you a scholarship. You know, we've got criteria, we've got all this kind of stuff. We've got admissions criteria. I'll tell you what, you sit for the GMAT. You know, I'm leaving for the US in 2 days' time, so sit for the GMAT, and we'll see how you do. Give us your college transcripts. I've done some college up here at one of the city colleges. I've done some maths and C programming and other classes and stuff. Let's see how you're doing from your work experience and all the rest. So put it together. I only had 1 day to study for the GMAT. I never looked at it before. People usually spend 6 months trying to prepare for it. And so I just jumped in there. I didn't finish it. I got like 95% of the way through. You never know quite how you've done on that because it's a little subjective. It's not just like math where you don't got the right or wrong answer. And I basically thought that's toast, you know, just forget about it. You know, we'll move on. I was back at Drive Cam again. And I got this phone call on New Year's Day, but from Queensland University of Technology. They said, you scored in the top 5% of the GMAT. You got a 4.0 out of 4.0 GPA on your college classes. You've met our admissions criteria and criteria for a full scholarship. So it's like I got this full ride scholarship, and I'm like, well, what am I supposed to do? You know, so I jump back there, and this kind of is this ironic reconciliation between my utterly failed, you know, childhood of academia with school, and now I'm like jumping into the whole academic scene. So I thought, well, I actually better try, you know. So I put my best efforts in, ended up graduating in the top 1%, summer cum laude, and then went on and thought, well, while I'm at it, maybe let's try a Master of Engineering Science. And again, I didn't have the undergraduate degree, so I had to go through the whole routine again. And they said, we'll only let you be in basically, on academic probation. So we're going to see what your grades are and stuff, and if you're struggling, then we'll just call it a failed experiment and you can, you know, you say at least you tried. So again, you just, you know, when opportunity presents itself, and a lot of this, what we're talking about, this isn't anything special about me, it's the same things which is accessible to every single one of you, and that is the decision to give it your absolute total commitment. It's perseverance, it's diligence, it is failing to give up, it is taking on the difficult, really difficult challenges. Yeah, and it wasn't easy, but again, I graduated with a 7 out of 7 GPA, so perfect GPA, and then went to Austin, Texas. I received an entrepreneurial in residence at the Austin Technology Incubator. So I was helping other startup companies at that stage. I had a startup I was working on myself, and I'm a big believer in a big component of your success is the people around you. It's the people that's supporting you. It's the people that you bring to travel this sacred journey with you as an entrepreneur, and they can be. They can be your employees, they can be your top management team, it can be your family or your spouse, it can be your investors. And you know, there's good money and there's bad money. And there's good investors and there's bad investors, and I've seen them all. So I try to avoid the bad investors, but if you've got good investors, you want to look after them. Yeah. And some of the people in the room here with me have been they've been with me on this journey with different entrepreneurial ventures for, 15 years or more. Is it, you know, 10 years as an investor and 20 years or more watching the entrepreneurial journey with me. And this one product which I had called PillowView, this is one of the ventures that I chose not to go ahead with. It's essentially, and this is going back in time now to the year, we're looking at 2004. So LCD big screen TVs were still really, really expensive. And if you wanted to watch TV in bed in your bedroom, if you stick a TV on the dresser, you're going to be, okay, I'm lying in my bed. This is my bed mattress this way. And if the dresser's down in front of you, you're basically doing this, propping some pillows up, looking at the TV that's in front of you like this. And I thought, that's not comfortable. And a lot of the time when you're in your bedroom, it's dark, you know, it's nighttime. So you don't need a really bright screen, but you need a big screen. So the idea was, come up with a TV projector about the size of a small box of Kleenex, you stick it on your bedside table, and it projects a 60-inch big screen TV right up onto the ceiling in front of you. So now when you're in bed, it's like right there in front, perfectly comfortable. And the price point was going to be $299. We're going to be selling it within, you know, on the infomercial market, so direct to consumer. And that's the business model that I started down. So I built prototypes. We're gearing up. Do you mind if I call you out?
No.
All right. So Matt and Tina here, they actually invested in the venture. And as I got started gearing up towards completing the design and getting ready for manufacture, the FCC, bless our government, they decided to step in and change the criteria for ATSC digital tuner, any television of a 26 inch or larger viewing size had to have a full ATSC digital tuner, or you wouldn't be able to sell in the US market. So it's a legislation they brought in while I was preparing to sell. And to comply would have meant an almost doubling of our product costs. It would have been a $500, $600 product at that point. And I just felt instinctively, you know, it's not going to work. So I actually pulled the handbrake. I ended up giving 100% of the money back to the investors and taking about a $100,000 hit on it myself. But I just felt, you know, it's important to, this was my decision. I didn't, you know, I did it fairly early, and I thought rather than exposing my investors to it, I'll look after them. And if you look after, you know, if you look after the people around you, they look after you, and it becomes this relationship of trust to where you can do great things together. And, you know, the world's got enough risks and problems and headaches and treachery without, you know, without needing it from those around you as well. So I think that's, if there's a message here, it's look after the people that help you succeed, because they are as much of a part of success. What you provide is the vision and the commitment, but in a sense that doesn't make you that special. I mean, it does, but because without that and without a champion, it's never going to work. But without the people around you, it's never going to work either.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Thank you. Now, you went from EIR in Austin, Texas, right?
Yep.
Excuse me.
That
Austin was easy
Technology
to say,
incubator.
Wasn't it?
Yep.
Water, please, or tequila. So you went from EIR in Austin, and you came back to San Diego. Is that when you started to develop the concept around LifeProof?
Well, actually, my wife, she loves Surfers Paradise and the Gold Coast, and when we're getting tired of Austin because of just the nasty allergies there, and the weather wasn't that great. So moved back to a beachfront place in Australia. By this point in time, I managed to sell some of my stock in DriveCam. So it was for the first time in my life financially independent. And so I was living kind of the beachfront life, you know, retired. And after about 6 weeks, realized this retirement thing was kind of stressful. You know, I mean, there's only so much surfing you can do, and running and, you know, hanging out and doing cool stuff before you start getting... being able to create is such a blessing. I mean, when God gives you a talent, and each of you have got great talents of one kind or another, and if you haven't discovered it yet, make sure you do, because it's each one of us has one. If you're not deploying that talent, there's something inside the human spirit that's not okay with that. That starts to feel like this is not right. You need to be productive. You need to enjoy life. You need to enjoy relationships, but you need to be productive as well. And I started taking my phone and getting sandal in it on the beach and dropping it on the bike and having it shatter. And then my young daughter ended up throwing it in the bathtub. And, you know, so my phone was like the cat that kept getting ran over, but except it only had one life, not mine. And so I bought an OtterBox case at that point in time, which was this big, thick, rubbery thing that whenever the phone rings, you try to pull your phone out of your pocket, and you're trying to get it out before the phone stops ringing, and then, you know, your pocket turns inside out and all that sort of stuff. Sorry, guys. I mean, I know you bought my company, so I don't mean to be too harsh on you because this is, you know, how it all started, honestly, but we all learned along the way. So I thought at that point, this is okay, but all the lint and dust is getting sucked in behind it and tearing up the phone and just all, you know, I thought, there has to be a better way. What if this idea about having to baby my phone, you know, like when you're like a freshman in college, you got that egg thing you got to carry around and you can't get it busted or anything for, you know, a month or whatever. I mean, your phone was kind of like this version of that. You know, I mean, what if every time your arm got wet, you know, it fell off or something? I mean, you know, how bad that would be. So I thought, what if you could just eliminate this whole stress over trying to protect this, you know, basically augmented intelligence? Because now you've got this thing that's mental telepathy. I mean, you can send messages without saying a word to people around the world, even, you know, massive groups of people. It's your memory. You can capture events and stuff that's happening that you can share with people and bring them there that were never there. You can call for help, you know, if you're out on your adventure and something goes pear-shaped. You know, it's this ability to, it's so much of what you do. And this is, it was really the awareness that on the fringes of societal change is where your biggest opportunities are. So if you're too early, then it's too early for it to be adopted. You know, there's too many barriers, it's not obvious enough. But by the time that it's obvious to a lot of people, it's too late. The opportunities are already out of the bag. So if you're looking for the next place of where the next big thing is, it's always on the fringes of environment of cultural and societal change. For example, with this big piece of glass here that lets you have this window into being able to touch the digital world, there was two big problems that it brought. First was when you drop it, it breaks.
I'll crack your screen, by the way.
Be the first time in 10,000 if I did. The second thing was that the battery, because you had all this glass and display, the battery... Oh my goodness, no, it works. The battery would get sucked down in half a day. So these two new pain points were generated. Entire new industries worth hundreds of millions of dollars, the protective case industry and the battery, the spare battery industry for phones, born overnight. So that's what you're looking for in terms of the next opportunity. So anyway, the commitment was, I want this to be life-proof. I want to be able to take it anywhere I can reasonably go in life and not to have to worry about my phone. But it has to be so elegant and sleek and beautiful that it doesn't degrade the experience of your touch, the sound, the photography, the way that it looks, the feel in the pocket and all of that. So it was a very difficult challenge, and I spent 2 years. And this is, again, when you make a commitment, I call it a commitment to awesomeness. You have to be awesome. You have to be utterly remarkable. You know, people talk about MVPs, like, we'll just get in with kind of, you know, a half-shitty product and see how it goes. And I personally, that's not really my philosophy. I think you have to aim high. You have to, and particularly when dealing with hardware, you know, it's hard to do a firmware upgrade on a piece of plastic. So we went through four to complete design generations. Each one of those, the first one, I could have said, well, let's get some money, let's try to get to market. But I just, it wasn't good enough. So the first time I was like, no, let's kill it, let's start again. Second time, no, let's kill it, let's go again. Third time, no, that's not it. Fourth, you know, so it was difficult because I had a certain amount of money which I was allowed to lose, and then we spent that, and then we're only halfway there. So then we put in double that, and then I'm getting close to the period of time where if I lose much more, we're going to have to think about, you know, selling the house and, you know, getting a real job. In fact, that's exactly what happened, is I tried to raise money for a year, and everyone's going, phone case? You want to raise money for a phone case? It's the stupidest thing I've ever heard. I'm not going to invest in that. And so all the angel investment groups I went to, the Tech Coast Angels here in town, guys in Austin, Texas, a bunch of other angels all around the world, they're all basically the same thing. No, I'm not, you know, I'm not going to invest in that. No one's ever going to want that. And so I ended up getting offered a job at Bond University, heading up their student recruiting. It wasn't a bad job. I mean, it's 160 grand a year, free company car, you know, kind of all of this sort of stuff. And I was literally looking over the edge of, I've got no more money to lose. We're toast. So kind of as a Hail Mary, I ended up calling Tina. I felt a little bit ginger about tapping that investor network again, just because with the previous venture had been the Pillow View, that which I'd given their money back, but, you know, I wanted to be sure about this. But I called her up and just basically said, I got this idea. By the way, I was starting this new job in 1 week, you know, so I kind of had to do something quickly. I said, I got this idea. Do you want to hear about it? She said, sure. So I jumped on a plane from Gold Coast, Australia to San Diego, next flight out, and I was over here, I think, the next day or something. And so Tina wrote me this check for $50,000. Matt wrote a check for, I don't remember exactly what the number was, something similar probably. And then the dilemma was, okay, so I've got enough money to get started but not enough money to get finished. The path of integrity would be to tell the university that my first love and commitment is this venture. And I'm not funded, but if I get funded, I'm going to have to leave. Now, if I tell them this, they're probably going to say, we can't hire you because we can't afford the disruption. And I knew that. But I thought the only right thing to do was to, in full disclosure, let them know and let them make their decision and just let the chips fall where they fall. Well, predictably, they said, you know, we really can't afford the disruption. You know, we need somebody to have the continuity, and that burn that bridge. Again, there's nothing like burning bridges to quicken your will to find a way. So again, we're just burning like crazy, developing, you know, getting the prototypes ready for production. I went for a competition called Launch Conference in San Francisco, and there's 4,000 applicants for that whole process, and there's 400 semifinalists, and there's 40 finalists. So we made it through the whole process to the last 40, and ended up. There's a pretty amusing YouTube video of. I was the only presentation on stage to not say a single word. So,
but did you?
Yeah,
that was
grand. The best. Yeah. And a tuxedo. Yeah. With classical music in the background.
Yeah. So probably it's the only presentation in the history of Launch Conference that never said a word the entire thing, and we ended up winning best of conference for best presentation of the conference, and that's kind of which launched the whole launch platform for LifeProof. And we thought we were going to be to market in February, March. And what ended up happening is that the manufacturing company in Taiwan, they thought that they'd make some optimizations to the manufacturing tool. And we have these very fine precision sealing surfaces which have to be literally microns of precision to be able to assure a perfect watertight seal. And they decided to put something called ejector pins to push the part out of the plastic mold without consulting us right onto the sealing surfaces. And that completely destroyed the ability to do a watertight seal. So these molds that we'd built, or that they built, literally had to be scrapped completely, and we had to start again from scratch, which put a 4.5-5 month delay into the whole process for launching. And in the process of that, we had 10,000 back orders of people that wanted to sign their name up for the waiting list. Now, we didn't take a deposit. We took their credit card number just as a kind of a sign of commitment, but we didn't do anything with it. So there was no deposits or anything else. So there weren't actually any money, change hands, or anything. But we started getting complaints with the Better Business Bureau, and I was literally getting death threats from people saying that, I mean, there were these weird stalkers saying they were so excited about their product, they wanted their LifeProof so much, they're basically threatening, saying, you know, when are you going to get this thing? There was these kind of crazy videos about this whole thing was a gigantic fraud and that we were scamsters and all kinds of stuff. And the Better Business Bureau ended up pulling us in. And we had to explain to them that these were not actually our customers. We had not sold them anything. And that, you know, they were just really excited about it. So we raised $1 million initially from a close network of friends. Both, you know, Matt and Tina are a very important part of that network here. And then an investor from Australia, ironically had to leave Australia to get money from an Australian investor, ended up putting an additional $1 million in. So we took $2 million in, and the month that we launched and started selling our product, Otterbox sued us. So they basically came in, they saw what a threat that we were going to be to their business. And they, in my opinion, it was a pretty grand stretch on the patent claims that they had, but they did what they could with what they had and basically tried to throw the book at us. And they were trying to get an injunction to stop us from selling our product and all kinds of things. Now, that meant that with these four lawsuits, we couldn't raise any additional money. And in hindsight, that was another blessing. Because when you can't raise money, you can't get diluted. And when you don't get diluted, if you find a way to make it work, your return is going to be much better in the long run. So we ended up fighting it out. It was literally, it was mortal combat with Otterbox. So, I mean, they were doing everything they possibly could on the street. There was all kinds of heavy influence that they were applying to their retailers to not do business with us. There was all the threats about suing our retailers that were selling our product, and they were trying to bury us in legal bills. So it was desperate times. We didn't know if we were going to survive, and we were in this kind of situation of hypergrowth and hyperthreat. I'd say it's probably the most hyper-competitive market in the world is the mobile accessories business. Just because you've got so many entrants which are coming into the marketplace, you've got such a big market, it's so attractive, and the entrenched competitors had a lot of advantages in terms of their distribution networks, their inertia, and all of those other things in the industry. So my survival plan was, we have to be the best in the world. I mean, literally the best. We have to have the best customer service, we have to have the best products, we've got to have the best team, we've got to have the best advertising and promotion, we've got to have the best loyal fan base, and ultimately we developed essentially a cult following with LifeProof. I mean, it was just absolutely ardent, it was vivacious. And we were attending 120 events a year where we'd literally go out to all the Rayner relays or Ironmans or Billabong Surf Classics or whatever was going on. And we'd be right there alongside all of the athletes and providing product and being there to support everybody on scene. And that was a big part, along with, you know, social media. Your LifeProof stories of unbelievable stories of people surviving plane crashes and capturing the whole crash on video and then being able to call for help, climbing out of frozen rivers when their car rolled over and crashed and they couldn't get help otherwise and their phone was submerged, but they found it and were able to call and get rescued and certainly would have died. There was three fishermen off San Diego here that went 5 miles offshore and their motorboat sprung a leak and they didn't have a two-way radio and they ended up in the water with their LifeProof case, so it was, you know, their phone got completely wet and they were able to call for help, and without that, virtually surely they would have been, you know, lost at sea and dead and gone. So those sorts of stories not only really made you feel good about what you were doing and the freedoms that you were being able to give people and, you know, kind of peace of mind, but it also made for wonderful, reality TV, so to speak, in terms of promoting the product.
You also had word of mouth military.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Which was grand.
Yeah, I mean, we've had a lot of special forces, Navy SEALs, people locally that have been promoting it and it kind of took off within the ranks when they realized what you can actually do with the product. Being able to rely on your tools and equipment is so important when you're in, when you're in harm's way. And so it's one of those very positive sorts of ventures where, in essence, you're promoting living life fearlessly, vivaciously, and being a part of something great. And I think that's where a lot of the team were proud to be associated with LifeProof. They enjoyed coming to work. And the culture was a really big part of our success as well. And this comes back again to looking after the people that help you succeed is so important, and being very selective with who you bring on board. Just as good people can really help you succeed, if you have poisonous people, they can be really just a toxic cancer which pulls things away. Now, if you have a company that's experiencing modest success, people are happy enough to have their job. There may be just a little bit of upside in their stock options or whatever else, bonuses, what else they have. Now, when you have a rocket ship, when you're that one in 100 companies or whatever the number is, which are just absolutely on a supersonic velocity, people start to see the potential. And you get two reactions. You either have the people which are very committed to trying to preserve it and make it great, or you have those which, again, they start becoming greedy and they're looking at ways like, well, how can I get myself a bigger piece of that? And so you start to see the best and the worst coming out of people. So when you're dependent upon people, they figure, hey, here's an opportunity where I can do a hold-up. What if I were to try to create discontent with a small group of others? We'll try to get you in a position to where we could sink your company, potentially, unless you give us what we want. And if you don't, we're going to destroy you. So you get into that sort of a situation, and it's happened to me more than once. But it's one of the curses of success which comes along. And I've learned you have to deal with that absolutely decisively. You cannot negotiate with that. You have to cut it out. And you have to take your lumps. you know, you're better off. You're better off taking your lumps, taking the risks of dealing with it, than to be down on your knees. Because it will destroy you in the end if you let them essentially gain control of the asylum or become, you know, let the inmates run the asylum like that. And cleaning house like that, it does, it sends a message that you're committed to excellence, you're committed to integrity, and if you're going to essentially do things which are harmful to everybody like that, it's not going to end well. So that's one thing to expect. We certainly had stretch marks with the growth. We went from 3 people to 250 people in 23 months. And, you know, so, I mean, it's hard just keeping up with everybody's name at that point. I can't say that in the end I did know everybody's name. In fact, there's this funny story where we're at CES. This was the year 2013 CES in January. So, again, Otterbox and us were in mortal combat. They were doing everything they possibly could to kill us. And two stories are merging together, kind of interweaving as merging together. But I saw Brian Thomas, who was the CEO of Otterbox, on their stand. And I thought, you know, I could go over and be a jerk and just go, because the last phone conversation I had with him was basically that they're going to kill us and that the only acceptable thing is that we are removed completely from the industry. So that was the last conversation negotiations we'd have with them. I thought, you know what, I'll just, instead of going up and yelling in his face or, you know, doing something like that, I'll shake his hand, I'll look him in the eyes and just say, it's good to see you. Why don't you come on over and have a look at our booth? You know, I'll just extend a, and I didn't have anything particular in mind. It wasn't, you know, there was no particular strategy to it other than you can't choose what happens to you, but you can choose how you react to that. And at that point, there'd been a bunch of new competitors coming to the marketplace. There were definitely, they were squatting on my patents. At that point, I'd had a huge IP strategy. I think we had something like 18 patents pending, had been issued 6 or 7. We'd had to start suing some competitors in the industry that were violating our patents. And Otterbox was wanting to get into the industry as well. And when they came over, you know, there was this apprehension and tension. You know, he was kind of awkward. He'd brought along the operations manager as well. You know, it's kind of like you're entertaining the enemy on your territory there. We had won, again, Best in Show for CES. We'd done this amazing, super creative booth where we had these life-size images. They're about 20 foot tall by 20, kind of these gigantic posters that were life-size of gigantic, you know, fire trucks or ski fields or, you know, cycling situations. We had the real equipment there as well. We had a whole kitchen set up to where you could bake a, you know, make muffins and cakes and get flour and water over your iPad and wash it under the sink and do all that kind of stuff right there, and had a hospital gurney with all the instruments, and a nurse that would come and give you an injection in the bum, you know, and all that kind of stuff. If, well, not really, but, you know, while you're, just to make it interesting. And so, you know, they were pretty amazed at what we were doing compared to their very sterile booth, which was little plastic bubbles with a plastic case sitting under it. They were selling plastic. We were selling lifestyle. We were selling aspiration. We were selling freedom. Their message was, buy an Otterbox so something bad doesn't happen to your phone. And we were selling the message, buy a life proof so you can make great memories. And the difference was utterly, I mean, it was utterly stunning in terms of the impact we were having on the market because of this. And that comes down again to knowing what you're really selling, knowing what your augmented product is sometimes not the core product. The core product was, you know, was a piece of plastic that kept your phone safe. The augmented product was essentially the carefree, life-proof lifestyle, to where you could do, be, capture, be part of anything, and take your mobile life with you. And what ended up happening is I looked Brian Thomas in the eyes and I said, you know what, this is stupid. I said, here we are. We're basically hatchet wrestling each other. We're trying to hack each other up with these hatchets on the mat. And the rest of the industry is going to come in and eat our lunch. Why don't we find a way to at least work together to try to protect our own IP? And I wasn't thinking anything more than, maybe we could come to some sort of a truce between us, but hold the rest of the industry off.
Sure.
Well, about 3 weeks later, I got this phone call from Brian Thomas saying, hey, we'd like to buy your company. And I didn't trust him at that point. I didn't, you know, I mean, it was such a deadly battle. I was like, yeah, right, you want to like lift my skirt, figure out where everything is, how to kill us, and then, you know, say no thanks, you know. But we found ways around trying to, you know, phase gate the transfer of information to which they'd be able to benefit from using certain intermediaries in the middle to be able to validate different, you know, pieces of information and so forth. And the more I looked at it, the more it made sense in terms of a great partnership, because they had the distribution network we didn't have. They had the supply chain, the manufacturing that that we didn't have, the economies of scale that they had. And the patent portfolio, their patent portfolio with ours, would have been unassailable, would have been tremendous. And so then I started to really see the benefit of it. And the number behind it too was something that helped to persuade me. It is possible to cry all the way to the bank. So the second interesting part of the story at CES was about employees and about knowing their names and why that can be important for you. I've been told that we had a new employee that that was starting at CES, and that they didn't, because they hadn't, all the rooms were booked out, the only spare bed they had was in my room. So they're going to be putting him in my room. So anything I knew was a guy, and that he was in my room. And I thought that he had an Indian name. So that's about all I kind of knew in terms of the picture. So we were all on the same floor in the Venetian, the whole LifeProof team, except for one, Bob Cotton, was on a different floor. But I'd forgotten about that. Well, he'd wanted to talk about the day and how it went and all that kind of stuff. So it was midnight. We went back to his room. We talked for an hour. It's about 1 a.m, as it is with CES. You never get any sleep anyway. And I knew that my room was all the way up to the very end of the hall, and it was on the left. And so everybody had been dumping their stuff in my room is the dump room, where you dump all of the different storage boxes and all that kind of stuff. And
goodbye, startup, right?
And so I didn't even know where my bags were in the room. So I put my key in the door, I opened up the door, and the lights were all on, the TVs playing and all that kind of stuff. But the new guy was asleep in the bed, and I thought, oh, you know, I'll try to be really quiet, I'll kind of turn the lights off around the place. And I go in and use the bathroom and stuff, and then I'm kind of looking around, I can't find my bag anywhere, and I thought, oh, too bad, I'll just do it in the morning, I'll just sleep in my underwear, right, you know. So, and then I'm looking in the bathroom, this guy is a pig, I mean, he's just like spread all of his stuff out, like he got the two sinks. Well, he spread his stuff out across all the sinks, like everything. And I thought, way to go, dude, new guy, and, you know, yeah, make yourself at home, all right, whatever. So I strip down to my underwear, I peel the other bed back, get into the bed, and then I'm looking at my phone, it's nearly a flat battery, so I pull out the charger out of my laptop bag, plug in, and as I'm messing with the little desk in the middle, something falls over, and the guy wakes up. And I'm thinking, oh, poor guy, I'm sorry. I'm really sorry. I didn't mean to wake up. Just go back to sleep. And the guy's like, okay. Kind of goes back to sleep. And then about 30 seconds later, he wakes up and he's like, wait a minute, who are you? And I said, I'm Gary Rayner. I'm the president. And I said, you must be the new guy. And he's like, new guy, what are you talking about? And I said, you must be the new guy that started today. I said, sorry about that. I didn't mean to wake you up and all that kind of stuff. And he goes, you're not supposed to be in my room. And I said, no, this is my room. You're in my room. And he goes, no, this is my room. And he goes, he said, what room are you? And I said, 10001. And he goes, this is 7001. So it turns out somehow my key worked in his lock, and it was the wrong room. And I'm wearing my underwear next to who I thought new guy was. Anyway, important to know who your employees are.
Well, thank you. That's a great story. So you were able to put together a deal with OtterBox.
Yep.
You, as you said, cried all the way to the bank, as I'm sure your investors did too. That's wonderful. So next was Interpreta, did you take some time off? And by the way, we have about 5 minutes.
Okay.
So.
All right. So... what was a 55 times return for our investors. So if you put in $1 million, you'd have $55 million, you know, back from that. So it wasn't a bad return on investment quarter. But I decided to take just a little bit of, well, I didn't get to take time off because as part of the transition with Otterbox, they wanted me on board to work with them on patents and all the rest of that sort of stuff. And part of that was I was the chief technology officer for their innovations group. It was a $12 million a year development budget, developing new product lines and so forth for them. So that was a great role. I really enjoyed that. They decided to try to increase their profitability and scale back on their investment. So I got to finish before my 12-month period was completely up, which suited me just fine. And at the same time, the two other co-founders of Interpreter, who I'd done business with before with Anvita Health, Anvita had sold to Humana for nearly $200 million. And I had joined them for a period of time when I was in Austin, heading up their business development, and had been an early stage investor in that venture as well. But they wanted to start this new genomics venture, and it was really intriguing because we're pushing a frontier, kind of a type of analysis that hadn't been done before, that would enable extremely fast real-time diagnosis of all kinds of both pathogens, as well as Mendelian diseases, as well as protein expressions and RNA expressions and all kinds of stuff in real time. So again, we got the team together, started working kind of stealth for a year's period of time, raised some investment again from some of the investors in the room and others, and essentially worked like crazy to build the analytics engine. A publicly traded company called Centene, so this is publicly disclosed information, I can share it now, at a valuation of $350 million, they made a $70 million investment in Interpreter, and the investors in Interpreter, again, came out with a very, very nice return on their investment for a one-year investment. And part of the deal was they didn't want to cash the founders out. You know, they want the founders to be committed to seeing continue to be successful and scale as it goes forward. So now I'm continuing to move that forwards with the rest of the team there. But combined, as far as the market cap, 550 for LifeProof, an undisclosed number, I hope none of you can do algebra, and also $350 million valuation on Interpreter, there's over $1.2 billion of essentially market cap generation now just between those three ventures. And tremendous return, you know, for investors as well. And about 2,500 man years of employment. A lot of that here in San Diego. So it's nice to be again part of the economy and seeing great things happen. And you too can be all part of making this happen if you have a vision, a commitment, a passion, a perseverance, and a commitment to learning the skills to make it happen.
Well, Gary, thank you. You mentioned something earlier, and it really resonated with me, and that's about societal or cultural change.
Yeah.
Be on the lookout for that.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want to steal any of your intellectual thunder here.
Why not?
Well, just because I'm hoping you'll share a little of the wisdom that you have or your thought process with our audience. Do you see, especially there are a lot of startups here and uh-huh. people that want to try something new. Do you see any opportunities in the Southern California market that you think are ripe to be addressed in the near term?
I think that's more than rhetorical, of course.
Of course.
You know, there's tremendous opportunity out there, but it has to be your passion. If you're looking for money, if your goal is to make a lot of money, you're almost guaranteed to fail. Because if that's your focus, it takes such a love, it takes such a passion and such a commitment to excellence that love of money is nowhere near strong enough to make you do the things you have to do to succeed. In fact, you know, occasionally I get weird stalkers which will follow me around and they'll come up and they'll say, you know, kind of like I'm this, you know, remember back in the alchemist times, he had these kind of alchemist geniuses, and I think it was, one of the discoverers of calculus essentially wanted to keep it a secret and didn't want to publish it because it was essentially his secret that enabled him to continue to make his income from being the way of solving these very difficult problems. You know, so it's almost like they expect that there's this one secret that you're holding out from in the universe that if only you'll share it, then they too can be rich, just like you. And basically what I tell them is, here's the secret, and it's guaranteed to work. I promise you. All you have to do is do everything that I did every day of my life, and you too can experience the same success I experienced. So basically, people want what you have, but they don't want to have to do what you had to do to get it. And it's that, again, it's that commitment. It's always, you know, doing the remarkable and amazing things is always hazardous. It's always difficult. It always appears futile and bleak. And there's going to be a lot of people that aren't believers. They're going to think it's, you know, how stupid is that? Because it's not obvious yet. So you have to believe in it. You have to have the passion and commitment to it. And you have to be prepared to take, you know, if you're looking for easy street, it's not going to be there. I mean, you know, you're going to go into so much debt. You may go broke, you know, more than once. You're going to have stomach ulcers. You're going to have times when you're looking over the edge and you think that it's all over. I mean, each of these ventures probably had four or five times in their life span where everybody else would have said, forget it, it's futile, it's over, you might as well give up. And, you know, just enough things were going wrong. And again, it's that tenacity to say, no, there is a way through it. I believe in this enough. We're going to make it work no matter what. Did that answer the question?
Yes, to a point.
You said what specific opportunities? You know, genomics, I think there's a tremendous amount in genomics and there will be continuing to be for a long period of time. And decoding what that actually means, because even still, you know, we can try to look at correlative comorbidities that are associated with alleles, and I hope I'm not getting too technical here and stuff, but there can be the complexity of the relationships. It can be more than one gene which is busted to cause a disease, and to start to realize the interplay of these different genetic factors, you know, is a new frontier. I think there's a lot of interesting opportunity with VR. My personal passion and where I think there's a lot of opportunities is in artificial intelligence, and that is obviously a moving definition of what that actually means. It can be even lifestyle associated things by the way that people are changing how they live. You know, example, Uber is one classic example. I think you have to ask yourself the question now, do I really need a second car? Or do I even need a car in the first place when I have to park the stupid thing and maintain it and do all of this, you know? So opportunities around changes of lifestyle, I think, are really interesting.
Yeah. Well, thank you. Open for Q&A now. So, and I'm going to let Gary pick.
Sure.
Miles.
Hi. So the biggest question that I have, great presentation, really interesting. The genomic stuff I think is really interesting to you. For somebody who's moving towards being a founder of a company like Interpreta, would going to school and getting a PhD be helpful in your opinion? And if not, what would be some things to do instead?
So there are three types of founders typically. There's three tracks to becoming CEO. It's either the technical track, or it is the marketing track, or it's typically the finance and operations track. And finance and operation track typically lends itself to more of a, I guess you'd call it a custodial or more of a business where operating margins are very important to success because you're in a more competitive situation where margins matter. You can be an innovator both from the marketing perspective as well as from the technical perspective. Ultimately, it comes down to the market because you have to be able to perceive an opportunity before it becomes obvious. And you have to be able to articulate that into an expression of solving a problem that people want and anticipate it that it's so well finished that you're solving many more problems than you create with the introduction of a new product and that it's enticing and exciting. So it can be if you take the academic track, and by the way, I'm by no means saying that being the unconventional kid that that was a miserable failure in grade school, that set me up for success. What set me up for success was my academic commitment to learning electronics and computers, homeschooling, instead of schooling. And so if you're going to be a high-tech entrepreneur, you're still going to need a lot of skills that you're never going to get if you drink beer and watch football as your primary pastime. So, you know, people think, oh, all I have to do is drop out and I'll become another Bill Gates. It doesn't work like that. If you have a very deep knowledge area with a PhD, that could be just the thing you need. For example, if it's a new innovative thing with AI or a new type of sequencing technology for genome or a new type of genetic analysis or something like that, then your big data analytic skills, your ability to put all of that together could be very salient. But I believe a generalist, a deep interest in a lot of areas is very important to be able to put together disciplines that wouldn't necessarily be obvious otherwise, to make the connections and find the opportunity that way. So if you do have the depth, try to find some way to, I think, tie that together with some breadth so that you're not too narrow focused.
Thank you.
Yes.
You mentioned distinguishing between good investors and bad investors. I'm wondering if you can identify some hallmarks of each.
Okay, well, I've seen a lot, everything from private equity groups to venture capitalists to angel investment groups to private investors to debt investors to bottom feeders and everything in between. The best sort of investor, I believe, is not the one that will never get in your way, but the one that will challenge you in the right way. So you want one that's going to be asking the hard questions, but not asking it with an agenda to condemn you or to crush you so that they can steal your lunch. You want somebody that is going to recognize you're human, that is looking to support and bolster your skills, that you have enough of a trust and rapport with where you can be candid about the challenges and they can help you find a way through it. Hopefully they also have added value experience to where they either have industry or domain experience, or they've got experience in how things are going to go when you're dealing with VCs, or experience with hypergrowth, or experience with employee problems, or whatever it is that you're facing. You want a sounding board that can help you through it. Last thing you want is somebody that tells you can tell them anything, and then when you actually do, they use it against you. So it's that fine balance. So naturally, you don't want to let everything hang out, you know, but you want to have that constructive relationship of communication and trust. The corollary of that would be an investor which is when they naturally they invested in you because that's your opportunity to begin with, and the sort which is going to try to doctor their way to causing you to fail or backdoor politicking your failure so that they can step in, take control, and then essentially eat your lunch. So oftentimes those characters will use their pedigree, their so-called pedigree and experience against you to contrast your inexperienced stupidity to their vast high pedigree amongst those influences around, which could be the employment, your staff, or it could be other investors or the board of directors, so that they can diminish your influence and try to increase their influence and possibly even try to step in, try to crash the company so that out of the goodness of their hearts they can step in at 5 or 10 cents on the dollar and save the company and end up with 90% of it themselves. In the end, I ended up with about 5% of DriveCam. And you know, as a founder, that's not the worst result, but it wasn't a great result. And choosing some of the wrong investors was a very big part of that happening.
Looking back, do you see that there were warning signs as to who those bad investors were? So, can you only figure it out after you've gone through the experience?
I mean, I could spot them a mile away now.
Okay,
but if you can learn from, you know, situations like this or trusted mentors, in I think it's by experience that you can, you know, you can ascertain. I think nothing succeeds like success. So if you have other successful founders that have a reputation for integrity and that they have a good track record and a good reputation, I think that's a great place to start. But just because somebody has money doesn't make them a good investor. And particularly if they don't have a lot of value add, you can get some real pains in the in the rear end.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Sorry, you go first.
Sure, real quick, focus.
Yes.
It's definitely the staple of success. So just out of curiosity, where do you draw, where do you draw from? What is your motive? What is your train of thought?
So I think it all starts with curiosity. curiosity, they say, is really, it's a hallmark of intelligence, and that's not self-congratulatory, because really it's an orientation. It's, there's probably a part of it which is innate, but I think there's also a big part of which is choosing to be curious, continuing to ask why, continuing to tell yourself that there's a lot you don't know, and just how exciting is that, you know, to discover these areas that you're interested in which you don't know about. So to me, when I know I'm in the zone, it feels like you're 6 years old and it's Christmas Eve. And that's what it should feel like when you're passionate about something and you need to find a way to keep that passion and that love for what you're doing when everything around is completely going crappy and terrible. Because that's the only thing that will keep you going, is that commitment to the vision, the total passion and the view of how great it would be if you could do this amazing thing that hasn't been done before and bring it to the world. There's nothing quite like the feeling of, you know, sometimes when I'm in Las Vegas, every single taxi cab in Las Vegas has a drive cam in it. And sometimes I'll get into a taxi and the drive cam's there, the guy's got a life-proof case, you know, on his phone, and he might be using interpreter and doesn't know it with his health insurance company as well. So it's when you can start impacting the world like that, you start to realize, you know, just a little dent, you know, a little tiny scratch on the universe, it's fun to do that. Eric.
Yeah, so life proof. We talked about lifestyle, how to improve people's lifestyle. You talked about the taxi cab driver, you see it on his dash, and then you just mentioned interpreter.
Yep.
So I'm wondering when we're going to see interpreter as a general consumer, when it's actually going to be relative to our lives.
It'll probably be impacting your lives, or I don't know specifically here, it depends which insurer you're with, and you know, but it'll be impacting lives probably in less than 6 months from now. It'll be live on tens of millions of people here in the US. So we'll be directly impacting probably at least 5% of the US population almost immediately. And we see that number going to the many, many tens of millions of people. And it's working on two fronts. It's both on the clinical analytics, which is looking at all of your claims information. You don't even know what's happening. We're basically looking at all of your lab results, all of your diagnosis codes, your procedure codes and all that, and just looking for every opportunity to making sure you're getting the best quality care. Because if you look after people and do the right things, funny enough, costs go down, and that's good for the insurer, and it's good for the patient. So doing good does good, but also we can look at the drugs that people are taking, look at the population risk that the drug they're taking may have a genetic component where it may or may not work with them, and figure out who needs to be targeted and tested, and how to interpret that on an ongoing basis to make sure that they're getting drugs that will be totally effective for them and safe. And there's nothing worse than taking a drug which is costing, you know, $500 a month out of pocket, and it doesn't work, and it's giving you side effects, and you're not getting better. You the opportunity cost of not getting better because there's a drug that would have worked, but you're not getting it. So there's all of those kind of aspects to it.
Will that only be available to some insurance companies, or will it be available to most insurance companies, or?
It'll be available to whoever wants to do business with us.
Yeah.
But it won't be a name that will be a consumer. It's not a consumer-facing name. So it's one of those. Will be one of those great companies you've never heard of.
I'm wondering, with your tech background, if you have any tips and advice for a non-tech company to transition to that. So right now, my company picks up cars while people are at work.
Yep.
Gets oil changes, then from car work, drops it back off, and I'm trying to transition to more of a tech aspect, almost like an Uber type thing, where they can press it and have it taken care of. But I'm not sure. Is it just maybe it's focus, maybe it's teach myself how to code or whatever it is. What's the next step for someone who's really formative?
I think it's understanding what you can do best. And if you were to try to teach yourself coding, I mean, you might do some wireframing, you know, where essentially you can kind of cut and paste things and make it look a certain way to create essentially storyboards and that sort of thing. But if you try to become a great coder, it'd probably take you years, and if it's not your passion, you'll never be a great coder. You might be an okay one at best. So what you can do best is articulating what it is that's going to make a great experience. And when you articulate that, you want to put it into something called a requirements document. And it's tempting, and I see the same mistake over and over again. Like, we're so smart and we're so cool that we don't have to plan this stuff. We can kind of do it, you know, ad hoc, seat of the pants, and it's much faster that way because the rules of gravity don't apply to us because we're too cool. And if you don't take the time to take that more disciplined approach, and I don't mean getting bogged down into like some big Qualcomm process or something like that, which is appropriate for a very large company with thousands of engineers, you've got to pick the right size process that can help you express what it is you're trying to build in a way that you can communicate kind of its common language. So instead of trying to become a great coder, you might want to learn more about UML and other sorts of use case languages and requirements documents to where you can create a document. It might not be a long one. It might be a 10 or 15 page document, which says, this is what we're trying to build. Then you can bid that. It's a common language now, which you can take to many different development groups. The less ambiguity there is around what you're going to build, the less it's going to cost you. Because there's this, these development houses love it when you don't really know what you're doing, because they'll give you $100,000 quote to begin with, and then by the time you finish and you get out to market, it's $2.5 million with all of the scope changes and requirements changes and all these other things which they'll lay on you. You could have probably done it for $200,000 if you had have carefully embodied a great expression of exactly what it is you're trying to build to begin with. But by the way, what I mean by that is not being so rigid that you don't learn I don't mean being so waterfall oriented in terms of specifying every little teeny button and feature that you don't deviate, but you've got to have a very, very clear view of what you're building from the beginning so you can begin that that process. Yeah. Yes. Yes.
Okay, so as a mad scientist inventor, you probably have ideas constantly, all the time. While you're working on something, you probably have already thought of 10 more things.
Yeah.
How do you settle on one thing, and how do you stay laser focused on that one thing without distracting yourself?
Well, there's times when you just have to let the muse visit and just let it flow through you. And I don't mean that really it's not like I'm not a supernatural believer in the muse or anything like that, but there's times when inspiration comes and you just take it and you just stay up all night and you document it and you say to yourself, this is really awesome, but I don't have the bandwidth all the time right now to do it. But at least I've parked it. Maybe I'll spend 40 hours and file a patent on it. Or maybe I'll do a little bit of market analysis, because then you think it's a great idea. But again, coming back to putting some of the discipline to starting to validate your idea before you start putting a bunch of resources behind it. I know people quite well who think that they are so smart, again, that the laws of gravity don't apply to them. So they don't bother about checking with annoying things like what the competitive landscape is, or what customers might want and all that kind of stuff. The more disruptive your product is, the less your customers are going to know right off whether they want it or not until they actually see it embodied. But that's no excuse for not having a process around understanding the driving need, which is different than the actual embodiment. You have to prove the need, prove that you're creating a new demand. Focus. Even recently, I've been discovering, because what happens is I get other people approach me with investment ideas and so forth. I'm in several different investments, and those things invariably. They're like children. They don't behave well all the time. They need their diapers changed. It's messy and smelly and all of that sort of stuff at times. So it takes a lot more of your time than you expect. And the current business is very demanding. And I'm realizing with a lot of travel, I'm approaching burnout. And so recognizing when you're approaching burnout, taking some time back and saying one thing at a time, and giving yourself time between ventures as well. That's often where a lot of inspiration will come. is take some time to have the downtime, be with it, and then you can articulate it. But I think you can really only do one thing well at a time. If you try running two companies simultaneously, I can't do that well.
So based on that, kind of going to not spreading yourself too thin, right? So a lot of very successful people are very successful because they're very good at the one thing they do very well. and they know when to basically drop off the rest of the work to other people or kind of outsource. So how do you know not to spread yourself too thin? How do you go, you know, when you put beyond your passion, beyond your vision, how do you know what you should focus on?
When you start sucking at what you do, you need to find smarter people than you at that.
Yeah. Awesome.
And that's usually pretty quick. You have to be very careful with that, and you prove it out. And again, it comes down to building a team of good people that you know you can depend on.
Kind of when you lose your love for it, right? Because when you love what you do, you don't work it in your life.
I don't necessarily agree with that. I think there's a lot of times when everything is going bad around you, and you've got people behaving badly right beside you, and everything's imminently looking to completely fail. It's never fun, but you're still looking at that commitment that you have, you know, in the long term, and that's what sometimes keeps you going.
Two more quick questions, please.
Yeah.
Hi, Harrison Shane. I run a web development and also a design agency, and we're consumer-focused, consumer-centric. We work with a lot of different clients who have their own products. My question is, you know, because we work in development and design, we work with marketing, they work with the product itself. Can you talk to us a little bit about why it's more important, or why you feel like marketing is more important than the development? Because I've seen a lot of products that haven't have the budget behind it, and it shows once you actually get into the product versus the hype machine behind the product. Can you kind of talk a little bit about the gap between marketing and the actual product itself?
People confuse marketing with being something you do to people. And I don't think that's the best type of marketing. That's outbound marketing. That's where you say, I have this message and I want you to know what we have. And that's very, very difficult in these days, because there's so much noise, there's so much clamor for these messages. It's extremely expensive to try to get mind space to be able to get that message across. Ultimately, good marketing, it's a conversation that you have with the consumer. It is the conversation you have to understand their need. They may not even be talking to you. You may just be listening by watching, by articulating a need and starting to test that. And to, as you're seeing confirmation or like you're not quite hitting the mark, you keep adjusting. But ultimately, it's still a communication with the customer or with society or with the need that is being expressed. So that's why good marketing is utterly essential to the success of a product. And the best part of that good marketing is the listening part. It's not what you do to people. Did that answer it?
That was Karen? Very good.
Okay.
One more. I mean, if nobody else, I can probably fire questions off all night.
Yeah.
But you talked a lot about building a team.
Yeah.
What are a couple of places where you would go to find those people?
So it depends on what stage of the business, because different types of people will be attracted to different risk profiles. I mean, for the entrepreneurs that are just starting out, we're the crazy ones, right? You know, so we're throwing in the towel to job security, to bonuses and stock options and mortgages and things like homes and comfort and, you know, all of those sane sorts of things. We're basically throwing caution to the wind. Well, not really. I mean, it's a calculated risk, right? But there's a pretty good chance that it isn't going to work out. And so you better be committed to make it work out. So you've got to find people that are crazy enough to join you on that journey if you don't have any money. And if you're as either co-founders or early stage, for example, I know Joe Lonsdale. So he's one of the founders of Palantir. And the way he likes to do it is he has a reputation and the cadre now to where he can essentially go to these new grads from Stanford and say, I tell you what, you've got a job out there, offer for Google, you could go work for $180,000 a year, you know, with your data science background. I'm going to offer you 45. And you're going to join me, I'm going to give you a big lump of stock options, and we're going to build this into an amazing company. And if you're not willing to work for 45, I don't want you, because you don't believe enough in the dream, you don't believe enough in the vision to make this work. And you can find some closet to live in, you know, in the Bay Area for 45, but not much more. So enjoy top ramen. I hope you've got enough flavors that you like there. And that's the people that he hires to build these people, because they're in boots and all. They're committed, they're passionate, and they're going to find a way to make it work. If the sort that you're hiring is the only reason you hired them is because you offered $5,000 more than Google, you know, you've got, Google has things to offer you don't, you know, whether it's great laundry plans, or you know, or chair massages, or just the, you know, the cachet of having to work, you know, worked at Google, and the networking and all that. So you're at a disadvantage from the beginning. If money is your primary motivator, then people will be promiscuous. They'll just go to where the next $5,000 is, or, you know, if you start approaching hard times a bit, they're going to go, oh, it looks like this thing's, you know, not going to work out. I'm going to jump ship now. And it'll be the opposite to a virtuous cycle. It'll be a very negative, damaging cycle. So I guess you got to, you know, choose as the risk, as you burn down the risk, then you want to give away less stock in the company because it's very expensive for hiring, and you're going more towards a traditional, more of a traditional employment configuration. But you still want people to be there because they love the vision and the mission, not just because of the paycheck.
So being selective. Friends.
Oh, friends.
Or
you,
like,
bring up, no, well, we're going to address that one. So, if you hire friends, most of the time that won't work out. And they won't be your friend afterwards. My policy now is basically never hire friends and never hire family. And because those relationships are too precious. And there's a social contract which is presumed, that they will presume onto you, that you never agreed to, that somehow the rules of employment are different for them than it is for everybody else. So once you're going to have to start holding them accountable for, you know, walking into work at 9:45 each day and, you know, letting it hang out in other ways, they're going to become offended that you are, you know, that you're not treating them like a bro. Like, that's uncool, man. And, you know, and that is just, and conversely, the presumptions typically escalate, and it can get to the point to where they feel that because they were family, just somehow because they were family, they should be getting 10 times the amount of stock options as somebody else. But they don't tell you that. They don't necessarily ask for it. They just presume that, and it can manifest itself in, and I'm not talking about family in this circumstances. I haven't had a bad family situation like that, but I've had friends that I've tried to help out that ended up, two of them, that became so ridiculously presumptuous, they ended up suing me for completely unsubstantiated what they felt was stock options that they should have been entitled to, that were utterly, totally out of the realms of reality and could not possibly be supported under any circumstance. And when you have investors, you have a fiduciary responsibility to each and every one of the investors to protect their shareholder value. You can't go doing bro deals with, you know, with people. So you have to hold everybody to the same standard. So if you had to choose between definition of trustworthiness, what often happens with friends is this implied social contract of, I'm loyal to you. I'm always going to have your back. I'm always going to be there for you. You can count on me to make sure that nothing bad's going to go wrong for you, Mr. Gary. But the implied social contract is, you're always going to do everything I like too. And so if you start doing things that they don't like, what happens is the people that are on board when the company is 20 people, your VP of sales and marketing is going to bust when the company triples its revenues or quadruples its revenues. He or she won't scale, most likely. And you're going to have to either move them laterally, move them down, or fire them. And very, very, it's very unlikely that they will make the transition graciously to step aside and let somebody else that has the skill at the next level of the company's growth and transition to bring that success in. And then that person's going to bust when you can quadruple your revenues, and you're going to have to switch people in that can work and grow with the business. So if their definition is, you always look after me, you're going to find that the ferocity of that loyalty is going to turn white hot to hatred and to vitriolic determination to destroy you. when you have to remove them sideways. You won't be training them, even when you look after them with stock options or whatever else. Most likely they'll be very ingracious. And if it wasn't a friendship, they would be more likely to realize that's just business and, you know, it was a good ride. Nice to have on the resume. I would rather the definition of loyalty being that no matter what, they will always tell you what they think. And that they will always be authentic with you, even if that means possibly offending you. That's my idea of integrity and loyalty.
Thank you.
How about a big round of applause?